Okay, hello everyone. Thanks for surviving so far. I don't think I've searched my whole life for something, but that's okay. So initially I was asked to do a presentation on what drives people to do science and to what extent they go to do this work. And it was not that easy actually to think of all those reasons. But then I was helped in a way when I looked back at my previous mentors, or even actually my current students or the staff, and then try to tease out and then read what others have been thinking to the extent they go. So the first thing is what motivates someone to do science. So there are so-called external factors which are not written here, and these are basically egotistical factors, like, you know, I want more fame, or I want an award, I want to be famous, I want to earn maybe not money for like regular living, but you know, money as in very greedy money, or you want to tell people how smart you are the smartest in the whole room. I guess it works out also in a way, but it's not these kind of factors in the end leave you adopting unethical means or undesirable means towards achieving those goals. And then there are your personal or very internal factors, which is, well, maybe you think you are trying to help people in a way. What you do helps people to live better, or you have the joy of finding new things, or you like studying complex things, finding simpler patterns among these, enjoying the whole process of obsessing and then doing something, regaining a result, and then of course you want to make a career out of it. So that's fine. So with this motivation, I'll just go on a smaller part of the whole science, which is environmental health, which is basically the aspects of public health on how different environmental factors influence humans or also wildlife. So, you know, mostly when we talk about public health, we are concerned about acute exposure and their effects. Like if you drink really polluted water, you have diarrhea about, or, you know, you consume something in one go and then you go to the hospital. But these are more concerned with your everyday exposure. So, you know, a lot of us work in indoor environments. The indoor walls are impregnated with flame retardants. Some of them are also now known to be toxic, but then we are not aware of all that, right? You live in an indoor building, you go in your car, your foam is also impregnated with another flame retardant, the cushion of your seat, and then you consume water or are different food products, which are also somehow, you know, impregnated with one chemical or the other. There are almost 30 to 50,000 chemicals in circulation in the society. So this is like, you know, so our sort of anthropogenic needs, the industrial process is driven. So one, you are exposed through the product itself. Your shirt or your socks or your coat can be impregnated with nanoparticles. Some of them are again toxic or non-toxic, depends on which particle you're looking at. You know, your food packaging, food itself that you consume. So one is the consumer product itself, which after reviews goes to waste. Then you have industrial processes that drive your requirements. So then that things also goes to the environment. Eventually all of this ends up in the humans. So of course babies or, you know, pregnant mother and other human beings. And all of this has endocrine effects or neurological effects or cardiovascular effects. So this kind of work, I thought, is something that encapsulates all sort of intrinsic motivation, that, you know, it helps people in a way if you think, if you take a step back and think broad enough on what exactly is driving you to do something. Then it has so many complexities, and somehow you have to look at all of it and make a sense out of it. And then in the end, you know, you get a reward that maybe you find something, or you create a piece of code that helps you find some number of exposure of how much I would eat something in a day, or I'm exposed to a certain chemical in a day. So that was like the first part. The second is which extremes you would like to go to do research. And here actually I would prefer to take examples of what my students are doing now. So like, you know, community health or a community-wide survey. So these people, these are some of my staff, which basically went to remote parts of Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, and here they are working with pregnant women to understand their exposure to mercury, which is a neurotoxicant, and then they are also following the babies for their anthropometric effects. So then we are trying to relate how exposure links to postnatal health quality. Then another set of students, so this is like an extremely polluted place in South India, a power plant, and then this is actually where people are living. This is next to the power plant near to fly ash pond, and it's really poorly managed. And there again, they are doing collecting like biomarkers or here with also in collaboration with a colleague, they are looking at bone lead levels, how over lifetime exposure would have ended in their body burdens. This is last week, and again, this is at this time of the day. So it would be 40 or 42 Celsius outside, and then they are, you know, collecting water samples to estimate the environmental pollution. I don't think they are looking at messages. They are recording the GPS coordinates. It's not, they are not looking at messages here. And then they are collecting samples over here. So these are like, and then another set of students, soon after Kerala floods, during the recovery phase, they have been to these exposed areas where flood has occurred. And then they are trying to find, okay, what is the virus contents, or you know, what is the exposure to bacterial aerosols of people who are living in these flooded environments. And if it is high, then how can simple interventions such as fumigation or, you know, wearing masks, these simple interventions can help them to be less exposed to such kind of pollutants. So these are very local. And then, of course, you want to see the effect of these industrial emissions on the environment. And then again, you know, so one of my postdocs, he went from Mauritius to Bharatiya Indian Antarctic Station on a ship cruise. So this is him on the ship collecting samples. Of course, you also see the penguins sometimes when you're close to Antarctica. And you know, some of the times he told me, and he has the video which I could not show right now. So the, like the ship is rocking, and then he feels like, okay, you know, this day is going to just go away. But of course, he's alive, so that's good. But you know, there's instances like when you really have those kind of environments. But the main thing is that you have to somehow buy in of all what you are doing. So if you are always, you know, if sometimes you worry about why am I doing this, it's probably better to take a step back and, you know, think why I started studying this, or not studying, but anything else actually. Whatever profession you are in, maybe you have to take a step back and see, why did I start this, or why did I go into this profession in the first place? And then, I know sometimes what you are doing exactly is not going to be really, you know, physically you may not be able to see what you are doing to take fruition. Like, you know, maybe you are in a lab pressing a button and then noting something, or, you know, typing a code and then it goes in another code, another code. But as long as you can see the whole big picture and, you know, sort of you buy in the idea, and then everything becomes, you know, much more easier. Rather than, you know, just go in one stream and then you worry, oh, why am I even doing this? Why should I bother? So I think that's the whole idea, that you can go in whatever extreme locations or extreme environments you are in, can be, you know, in very near you or can be away from you. But as long as you know that, you know, your driving motivation is some kind of internal, intrinsic for the love of the thing, and if it is helping something or helping people, making things better, I think you can just go ahead and, you know, finish it off, and most chances are that you would be successful in all the external factors like recognition and fame and awards, they will follow. So I think the first thing is to do good work, and then everything else will follow. So basically, if you really want to do something really nice, I think what you have to have is a problem that you think, that you really believe is worth solving. Then, you know, there is a phase where you have to, you know, obsess over the process, whatever the ups and downs are, and then, you know, eventually, hopefully more often than not, you will be very successful. After you're successful, I think it's good to enjoy it for a small while and then quickly move on to the next thing, because there are other things to do. Thank you.